Good morning, and welcome to worship here at Brenham Presbyterian Church online. And if you're a visitor with us this morning, please be especially welcomed. Perhaps you've tuned in this morning for some spiritual companionship, and if so, please know that you are very welcome at our worship service this morning. I'd like to begin by introducing my co-worship leader, the Reverend Kristen Golly, who's also my wife, and she is the interim senior pastor at University Christian Church in Austin, Texas, and we're glad that you're with us this morning, Kristen. There's a lot going on in the life of your church. We'll get to that a little bit later. Let us worship God together. Let us begin by listening to our prelude this morning, I Will Rise and Go to Jesus. Please join me in the responsive call to worship you'll find in your bulletin this morning. God has searched us and known us. God knows when we sit down and when we rise up.
God searches out our path and our lying down. God is acquainted with all our ways.
Before a word is on our tongues, God knows it. God's hand is ever available to guide us.
Such knowledge is a wonder to us. It is beyond anything we can attain.
We cannot escape from God's Spirit. There is nowhere to flee from God's presence.
No matter where we make our bed, even in the darkest place, God is there.
Let us worship God together.
Please join me in prayer as we pray the prayer of adoration. Gracious God, you have searched us and known us. You indeed discern our thoughts from far away. You lead us in the way everlasting as we gather to bless you for your bountiful mercy, for the compassion and care you extend to us. We give you all praise as we assemble in Christ's name. Amen.
Please join us in the opening hymn this morning, Praise Ye the Lord the Almighty. You'll find it in your worship bulletin this morning.
Thank you.
pray with me as I pray our prayer of illumination. Ever-present God, to whom each of us is fully known, and before whom we bow in awe, by the power of your Holy Spirit, help us hear your living word, still speaking this day, so that we may live in ways for all the world to come to know you and recognize your teaching. Amen.
Well, I'd like to invite the young disciples, regardless of age, come forward, come closer to the screen for our time together. Well, do you like superheroes? You know, comic book superheroes? I know that I do. Whether they're Marvel Comics or DC Comics, I've always loved superheroes. And I've brought a few this morning. Do you recognize this superhero? I bet you do. He's a little older one, but that's Superman, right? The Man of Steel. Maybe some of you recognize this one, a newer superhero. Can you see him? That's the Black Panther. He comes from an advanced city in Africa. He has super strength and the speed of a panther. Maybe you recognize this one. Her name is Captain Marvel. She can fly between the planets on her own, and she has super speed. Captain Marvel, a superhero. And maybe you recognize this one, a teenage superhero. You recognize him? That's Spider-Man. Well, what do all of these superheroes have in common? They stand for what is right. They stand for what is right, even when it's hard and even when it's difficult. They stand up for what's right in the world. That's what superheroes do. And you know, you can be a superhero too. Look, you can be a superhero standing up for what is right. It can be in small ways. Like this girl here. She's kind of like a Captain Marvel. She's comforting someone, isn't she? She's being a friend to someone. That's standing up for what's right. Or here. Another superhero helping his friend tie his shoe. It seems like a small thing, but his friend could trip on it and get hurt. So here, he's standing up for what's right. He's helping his friend. That's what superheroes do. I know that superheroes are in comic books, but they show us that we can stand up for what's right. And you see, that's what Jesus did. Jesus came into the world and touched the people who were hurt and crying and those that other people ignored and wouldn't help or go near. Jesus was kind of their superhero. He healed their hurts. He was a friend to them when they were lonely. He was kind of a superhero. And you know what? If you'll stand up for what's right in your life, you'll be a superhero too. Let's have a prayer. Repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for being a superhero. Help me to stand up for what's right and be a superhero too. Amen.
Our first reading of scripture is from Psalm 139, verses 1 through 12 and 23 and 24. Listen for the word of God speaking to us this day. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my thoughts. See if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting.
To continue with the reading from God's Word this morning, from the book of Genesis, chapter 28, verses 10 through 19. Jacob left Beersheba and went toward Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood behind him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham your father and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie I will give to you and to your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and in your offspring. Know that I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. So Jacob rose early in the morning, and he took the stone that he put under his head and set it up for a pillar and poured oil on the top of it. He called that place Bethel, for the name of the city was Luz at the first. To continue reading from God's Word, from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 12, verse 18, and verses 23 through 24. Here is my servant who I have chosen, my beloved, with whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he will proclaim justice to the Gentiles. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you tithe mint, dill, and cumin, and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. It is these you ought to have practiced without neglecting the others. You blind guides, you strain out a gnat, but swallow a camel. Friends, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. I love places of stone. I don't know why, but something deep within me is moved, touched, mystified by places of stone. Perhaps that is why I so love wandering through ancient ruins. I've walked through the ruins in Troy, Ephesus, Rome, Pompeii, Karnak Temple in Egypt, and even more. And when I walk through such ruins, I imagine that I can hear the sounds lost now to time. People shouting in the marketplace, chanting in the temples, arguing, living and loving, wondering and questing, so long ago, all in cities carved in columns of stone. I remember visiting Stonehenge in England, a place of standing stones. Those mysterious standing stones that were crafted and aligned with the heavens in the dim past of humanity. They are so intricate that we're still discovering more about them even today. Now, I visited years ago when you could walk among those ancient standing stones unescorted and unfettered. It was mysterious, powerful. It felt to me as if somehow the boundaries between realities were indeed stretched thin. Time and legend have no doubt increased their mystery and their romance, But still and all, in this place of standing stones, I felt as if I was standing in a boundary between this reality and something else. Places of stone, they demark places of power, where the real meets the surreal, where the everyday meets the mysterious. Places of stone mark where the sacred intersects the profane. Now, in our reading from the book of Genesis this morning, a place of stone marks where a mortal meets the divine, where a mortal meets the awesome, the holy other, the God. The mortal's name was Jacob, one of the three major patriarchs of Judaism, and he is on the run. You see, Jacob was a scoundrel, a very clever scoundrel indeed. As we meet him this morning, he has just cheated his older brother Esau out of his inheritance through some pretty sophisticated trickery. Problem was, Esau was bigger, meaner, and a lot better shot with a bow and arrow than Jacob. And he was really, really angry when he finally figured out that his little brother Jacob had cheated him. If we'd read a little earlier in the story, the book of Genesis sets the context and the background for our story this morning. Now Esau hated Jacob because the blessing with which his father had blessed him. And Esau said to himself, "The days of mourning for my father are approaching, then I will kill my brother Jacob." In other words, my father Isaac, the patriarch of the family, won't live forever. In fact, he's on death's door. And as soon as the old man kicks the bucket, well, let's just say that nobody ain't going to miss my little brother, because I'm going to kill him. So thought Esau. What do you do when the 900-pound gorilla learns you stole his bananas? Run. And that's exactly what Jacob did. He ran for his life. With his mother Rebekah's help, Jacob manages to escape the wrath of Esau. He set out on a journey to a far land, the land of Haran, there to seek sanctuary with his uncle Laban. Ah, clever, clever Jacob had outsmarted himself. And in so doing, he made for himself a hard place, a place of exile. He leaves town, his home, with a posse, real or imagined, on his tail. Finally, exhausted, he stops running long enough to take a rest. And that's where we meet Jacob this morning. Our scripture says he came to a certain place and stayed there for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. Jacob has run and run until he can run no more, at least not this night. But he finds no soft bed. No inner welcoming sanctuary, just a hard place of stones. But is that all it is? Just a hard place, a stony place? The Hebrew language here is rich. The word translated here as the place has a rather odd additional meaning. This rich Hebrew word also translates as a standing place, or a place where something stands. But Jacob has no interest in standing that night. He only wants to lie down, get some sleep. So in this hard place, he does not make a stand. He lies down to sleep. Perhaps he is so tired, so exhausted, that the modern euphemism is applicable, that he slept the sleep of the dead, symbolically, if not literally. But he has a dream. And in this dream, he sees a ladder set up on the earth, so the Hebrew says. The Hebrew, translated as set up, is a peculiar word, and one of its verb form gives the image of taking a stand. The language used to describe the ladder carries an overtone of a ladder that is standing upon the earth, reaching up to heaven. The Hebrews love double imagery in their descriptive language. The standing ladder is the place of taking a stand. Yet within all this imagery of standing up and taking a stand, there is Jacob, clever, clever Jacob, on the run from himself, now lying down, dormant. Here is an emphasis, a juxtaposition of Jacob lying down, sleeping the sleep of the dead, so to speak, in a hard place, a place of stones. Yet the vision he sees in his dream is not of dead, dormant stone. No, this is how Genesis describes the action on the standing ladder. The place he sees is a place of motion, of going and coming. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. The Hebrew word for angel, malach, means messenger. And here, as Jacob lies in the hard place of stones, does he have a vision of the motion of heaven, the messengers of God going up and going down, ascending and descending from the stony hard places of the earth to the ethereal brightness of the heavens. And then suddenly the Lord God is standing, taking a stand right next to reclining, dormant, dreaming Jacob. I am the Lord your God, he says. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and your offspring. Know that I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Here in this vision, he sees heaven not as remote, not as some faraway place, but as intimately connected to the earth, to the events of the earth, no matter how hard or stony those events may be. And Jacob wakes, stands up from his sleep, and says, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. Here Jacob is in a hard place, a rocky, hard place for a conniving little man with a stony heart. He's in the hard place of his own making, on the run, friendless, yet even there, God is with him. And the messengers of God are going up and down, and God is standing right beside him. It's as if God is saying to Jacob, you may be lying down, Jacob, but I am on the move. My messengers are on the move, and I will not leave you behind in your hard, stony place. Here is heaven, Jacob, not remote from the earth, but connected to the earth. How often have we laid down in our own hard place full of stones? A hardness of mind or soul or spirit, a hardness of attitude, a hard place of hard-headedness, a place of blindness. And just when we think that God is out of our reach, that we can do nothing but lie down, God reaches out to us, and in all that divine motion, God reaches down that heavenly ladder and says, I will not abandon you. You can make your bed in the hard place. You can make your bed in the place of stones, the place of the dead, in Sheol and hell itself. But I will not abandon you, says the Lord. Surely the Lord is in this place, even if sometimes we do not know it. Wake up, says the Lord, for you are sleeping the sleep of the dead. Stand up, says the Lord, for the place of stones in which you have made your bed can be so much more. Where are the hard places of your life? The Lord God will not abandon you, ever. Because this story gives us a vision of heaven that's not just up there somewhere far away, but rather connected to us, to the earth. And the word of God is constantly ascending and descending, constantly moving up and out into the world, into the hard places. Jacob was not just in a place. He was in a place of standing. And God was calling him to wake up, to stand up. And so he does. And in response, he raises a single standing stone. He anoints it and names this place of standing, this place of vision. Actually, he renames the place Bethel, from the Hebrew Beit El, and it means house or place of God. House of God. You know, I think that God is calling the houses of God, the Bethels of the world, to wake up, to stand up. I think now more than ever, we of the Christian faith are called to listen to the very one who leads us, who saves us. The Gospel of Matthew this morning describes Jesus in the words of the prophet Isaiah. Here is my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved, with whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he will proclaim justice to the Gentiles. We are the very Gentiles to whom Jesus came to proclaim justice. And his warning to his own people is applicable to us as well. A call to not neglect the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. It is a call to understand the vision of Jacob as powerful connection between the reality of heaven and the reality of the here and the now. Both are real, and both are connected. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The Bethels of the world, the houses of God, the churches of the world are called to stand up for justice and mercy and faith. But that is not easy. It never has been. Because the vision of God's justice granted to all on earth is an elusive one to live out. It has been hampered by carefully edited history. It has been short-circuited by the devices and desires of the world. It has been denied too long to too many. And it would be easy, as we look around at the fearful fruits of such in our lives, in our hearts, and in our streets, it would be easy just to take it all lying down, to stay asleep and wait for heaven to come to us, to sleep, perchance to dream our own dreams, but in so doing, miss the call to wake up, to stand up. We are called, all of us and each of us, to be a Bethel, a standing stone where the word of God moves from heaven to earth, and the will of heaven becomes a reality on earth for all. And it begins with a vision, a clarion call to encourage us to see the world around us with new eyes. So it was with a Presbyterian minister. His name is the Reverend Henry Highland Garnet. He was born a slave in Maryland in 1815, but his family escaped to freedom in New York when he was only 9 years old. He attended school and he advanced beyond high school onto higher education. Called into the ministry, he was ordained a Presbyterian minister. He served his first call at Liberty Street Presbyterian Church as their pastor, located in Troy, New York. On February the 12th, 1865, he became the first American of African descent to address the U.S. House of Representatives, less than 2 weeks after the 13th Amendment was passed, seeking to end slavery in the United States. In that address, Reverend Garnet was well aware that just abolishing slavery as an institution was only a first step in the vision. With respect to slavery and its aftermath, he compares it to the worship of the ancient monster god Molech, who demanded human sacrifice. This is part of what Reverend Garnet had to say that day. Let the gigantic monster perish. Yes, perish now and perish forever. Down let the shrine of Molech sink and leave no traces where it stood. No longer let its idols drink his daily cup of human blood, but rear another altar there to truth and love and mercy given, and freedom's gift and freedom's prayer shall call an answer down from heaven. Powerful image from a spirit-filled preacher, struck by the image of heaven intimately connected to the earth. But in a way, Reverend Garnet was a prophet too, for I think he foresaw the long road ahead stretching from his day even into today. He goes on to say, It is often asked, when and where will the demands of the reformers of this and coming ages end? It is a fair question, he said, and I will answer. When all unjust and heavy burdens shall be removed from every man in the land, when all invidious and proscriptive distinctions shall be blotted out from our laws, when emancipation shall be followed by enfranchisement. Here, my friends, is a standing stone worthy to be called a Beth-El, a house, a dwelling place of God. It is a vision not yet realized, but one that we can all uplift, we can uphold, and we can work for. For the messengers of God continue to connect heaven to earth and the will of the one who rules us all in mercy, justice, and faith. Let us awaken our hearts to the tasks at hand, to be part of making the dream of freedom a reality for all. In the name of Jesus Christ, who died for us all. Amen. May the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O Lord. Let us take a moment of silent reflection upon the word proclaimed. Amen.
Hear our call to confession. For when we run away from our problems, we discover that we cannot run away from ourselves. Yet God is present with us to hear our confession and offer forgiveness. God brings us back to face what we have left behind in order that we may claim the promise of reconciliation and wholeness. Let us confess our sins before God and one another.
Search us and test us, that all wickedness may be purged from us. O Creator, save us from our futile striving after our own advantage. Reshape our will to conform with your intentions for us. We confess that we have allowed weeds to grow in our lives. Our focus has drifted from the harvest you intend to the fears and greed that hold us hostage. Release us from the bondage to decay, that we may grow in likeness to Jesus Christ. We want to bear fruit for you. Turn us to the brightness of a new day. Amen. Let us continue with silent prayers of confession. Let us pray.
Amen. In Jesus Christ, we are set free from bondage to sin and death. Live then as free people who celebrate God's mercy and reach to others with justice in Christ's name.
In Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us enjoy our musical reflection this morning. Morning has broken. Please join us in the responsive prayers of the people this morning. You will find your response in your worship bulletin this morning. Gracious God, because we are not strong enough to pray as we should, you provide Christ Jesus and the Holy Spirit to intercede for us in prayer. In this confidence, We ask you to accept our prayers. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the church. Faithful God, you formed your church from the despised of the earth and showed them mercy, that they might proclaim your salvation to all. Strengthen those whom you choose today, that they may faithfully endure all trials by which you conform your church to the cross of Christ. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for creation. Creator of all, you entrusted the earth to the human race, yet we disrupt its peace with violence and corrupt its purity with our greed. Prevent your people from ravaging creation, that coming generations may inherit lands brimming with life. O God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the world. Sovereign God, you hold both the history of nations and the humble life of villages in your care. Preserve the people of every nation from tyrants. Heal them of disease. Lead them to peace. And protect them in times of upheaval and disaster, that all may enter the kingdom that cannot be shaken. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those who govern. God Most High, in Jesus of Nazareth, you show us the authority that pleases you, for he rules not by power or might, but serves in obedience to your will. We pray for the president, for the courts, for the Congress. Deliver them from vain ambitions, that they may govern in wisdom and justice. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all who suffer any sorrow or trial. Compassionate God, your Son gives rest to those weary with heavy burdens. Heal the sick in body, mind, and spirit. Lift up the depressed. Befriend those who grieve. Comfort the anxious. Stand with all victims of abuse and violence. Uphold those who live with addiction. Fill us all with your Holy Spirit, that we may bear each other's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. O God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
And now, as our Lord has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our
Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us sing, Hear Our Prayer, O Lord. Even in this time of pandemic, there is still a lot going on in the life of your church. Our worship committee and mission and benevolences committee and other committees continue to meet. Our finance committee continues to monitor the financial position of the church and tallies your generous gifts and tithes. The session of elders has recently met and discussed the business of the church. And more than just committees, we continue to be engaged with the needs of our community, particularly through mission and benevolences, but in other ways as well, particularly the Galilee Garden, who despite the heat continues to grow and distribute wonderful food in the name of Jesus Christ. There is a lot going on in the life of your church. If you have found anything of value in this worship service this morning, whether you're a member or a visitor, we would ask that you give prayerful thought and consideration to sharing some of your financial resources with our church in order that we might continue our missions. Some I know are regular givers and continue to give through the mail. If you would like to share by a check, you can send it to 1005 Green Street, that's Brenham Presbyterian Church, 1005 Green Street in Brenham, Texas, 77833. That address is a secured mailbox, and as I say, our finance folks pick that up, and we're deeply appreciative. Or, if you prefer, you can donate through our website, through the secure giving there, at brenhampresbyterian.org/give. These generous offerings help us to continue our mission and ministry here. Now, we know that for some, particularly during this time of pandemic, your livelihood may be uncertain or perhaps really uncertain, in which case we don't ask you to risk yourselves. In fact, we would ask you not to. We know that you must take care of your families. Instead, we would ask that you pray for the mission of Brenham Presbyterian Church and the many things in which we are involved. And continue, please, to dial up and dial in. Participate with us on Sunday mornings. I now would ask that you give prayerful thought and consideration to whatever it is that you can give. And let us enjoy our offertory anthem, The Mercy of the Lord.
Oh,
Let us sing our closing hymn together. You'll find it in the Worship Bulletin, Christ is Alive, all five verses. All find ourselves in hard places, stony rock places that perhaps we've made for ourselves, and it's easy to feel as if we are friendless. We are not. God has promised never to abandon us any more than God abandoned Jacob, which he did not. He was there. And the angels of the Lord, the word of the Lord, continues to connect heaven and earth together as we work for God's will to be done here on earth. There are those within our lives, within our communities, within our nation, within the world, who cry out for justice. And there we are called to stand with them in the name of Jesus Christ. But there are those beyond the walls of this church who still feel alone, perhaps. Perhaps they feel like they have no one that they can turn to. I would encourage you to reach out in a safe way through telephone or social media or email or however it is that you are contacting and touch them with the love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. Sisters and brothers in Christ, go in peace. Amen.